The story of Thomas Wentworth Wills is a triumphant story celebrating the life of a great colonial sportsman, the W.G. Grace of Australian cricket, probably the greatest cricketer of his time. Tom Wills captained the Victorian colony in the aggressive intercolonial cricket matches of the day from 1857 to 1869. In 1866, he travelled to Western Victoria where he coached and captained the first Aboriginal 11. They became the first Australian cricket team ever to tour England. It was Tom Wills who wrote the famous letter to Bell's Life, demanding a football game for cricketers to play in winter in order to keep fit. Together with five colleagues, he wrote the rules for Australian football. It was the first footy code ever, long before the rules for rugby or soccer were put on paper. The story of Thomas Wentworth Wills is a triumphant story, but it is also a tragic one. In October 1861, at the age of 26, he survives the massacre of his father and team of shepherds, stockmen and their families on Garden Creek, now called Murdering Gap, near Springshaw in the middle of a frontier guerrilla war raging between white settlers and Aboriginal tribes. The grandson of an English convict, Edward Spencer Wills, Thomas was born on the Molonglo Plains in August 1835 to Elizabeth and Horatio Spencer Wills. Editor of the Currency Lad and a shrewd and ambitious farmer, Horatio took up grazing land at Lexington at the foot of Mount Ararat in Western Victoria in 1840, before moving to Bellevue near Geelong, where he became a member of the Victorian Legislative Assembly, founded the Geelong Agricultural Show, and set about educating his four sons for suitable careers in the new colony. Tom's younger brothers, Cedric, Horace and Egbert, were sent to study agricultural science in Germany, while Thomas was sent to the famous English school Rugby to study law. But while Tom discovered his real talents were in cricket and football and not the law, his father met North Queensland pioneer P.F. MacDonald, who sold him 200 square miles of magnificent grazing country called Cullen Laringo, meaning sought and found. In January 1861, Horatio, accompanied by Tom and 23 stockmen, shepherds and their families, left Victoria on the steamer Telegraph for Brisbane. Some had worked for the Wills at Bellevue and Lexington. They proceeded to Toowoomba on the Darling Downs to pick up 10,000 sheep, cattle and bullock drays and travelled north overland to reach Rockhampton 16 weeks later after an arduous trip across much rugged and still unexplored country.
Went from Brisbane to Ipswich by steamer, and then went on to Gatton. And then from Gatton, they crossed the range going into Toowoomba. They then started to head across onto the Great Divide, the Great Dividing Range there, which followed on to Jambore Creek onto the Great Divide. Horatio Wills then went into Keppel Bay, which Rockhampton situated around Keppel Bay. Ordered these stores, hired a bloke by the name of Thomas. They come back out onto the Dee River, and the expedition range, they went to Comet River onto Albinia Downs, and from Albinia Downs to Conaringa. From Albinia Downs to Conaringa, they passed through Jess Rex's property range. Well, they started off in Brisbane in February and got to Conaringa in October.
50 miles from Cullen-Loringo, Jesse Gregson, manager of the Rainworth station near Springshore, warned Horatio of the fierceness of the Dawson River tribes and told him of the recent Hornet Bank massacre of the Fraser family some miles south.
Mr. Wells and his party have formed a camp about a mile beyond my boundary, Separation Creek, distant 21 or 22 miles from Rainworth. Wells seemed surprised to find my people and myself carrying firearms. He said he had firearms, but they were in the drays. He wanted to befriend the local blacks and to use them in his workforce.
The Wills party have moved into a situation where there were already seeds of a major Aboriginal European confrontation. Horatio Wills' party was certainly the best equipped and largest group to arrive on the Ngowa, and supposedly the best armed expedition to have entered the area. But Horatio ignored all warnings not to display supplies of food, clothing, blankets, and other stores. He failed to understand the recent tensions between blacks and the white settlers who were taking over the precious Aboriginal waterholes, scaring away wild game, disturbing sacred sites. Where Aboriginals were using guerrilla tactics to strike at white settlers were retaliating in their own savage fashion.
They were taking the Aboriginal country. The Aboriginals, they seen the country as their country, and they had to have a lot of country to live off of. You know, the food was very, very scarce.
On October the 5th, 1861, Horatio, Tom and the main party crossed Separation Creek and arrived at Cullen-Loringo to make their camp on Garden Creek. It was Horatio's 50th birthday. Jubilantly, he writes to his wife, Elizabeth.
My dear wife, thank heaven, Cullen-Loringo at last, the teams and 7,600 sheep all here. Baker and three men about 4 miles or so back with ewes and lambs. Tomorrow we unload two drays and start them back to our Binia Downs. Tom will go with the drays to see your right and look after the bullocks. Our sheep cross the boundary of the run, the southern boundary, Separation Creek, on the 3rd day of October, my birthday. Next day I went exploring with Jeremy Baker and was rather surprised at the size of this magnificent station. On one creek, I think called Spring Creek, alone 25 to 30,000 sheep in fair seasons could be well kept. Today, Mr. Patrick, Lieutenant of Black Police and Troopers, gave us a call. Upon my word, the weather, or rather the sun, is hot. Would to goodness our yards were up, our shed, and Baker and Tom back again. Yours faithfully, Horatio Wills.
On Thursday, October the 17th, one of the most significant Aboriginal attacks on European settlers occurred when 19 of Wills' party were killed. More whites died in this payback massacre than in any other conflict during the colony's frontier war.
The blacks had been coming in early in the morning, but in the afternoon they came back in bigger numbers, and then something happened in the camp and the massacre took place. Nobody really knows what started it all, but it was retaliation from something that the other white settlers had done in the area. Since Horatio's camp was unarmed, they reckon it was the easy picking out of the whole group. There's a couple of survivors, there was 19 killed, and two survivors were camping down in the creek banks in the cool, and they were woken with the screams. And after everything died down, Kenny was able to get Horatio's horse, which hadn't been damaged in the conflict, and rode to Rainworth Station to give the alert that the massacre had taken place. Afterwards, Jess Gregson formed a party to come across to see what they could salvage or put together. When they arrived, it was in the early hours of the following morning. They tried to locate all the bodies. They found Horatio just out in front of his tent with his head smashed. The others were killed at different locations around the camp. They buried Horatio in a grave by himself and 16 members in a mass grave. They're still two bodies short. After doing a bit more exploring and trying to round up the sheep, they came across two more bodies 500 metres away from their main campsite. These were buried on the spot because in October weather, the bodies were decomposing fast, so they buried them where they found them. By that time there, Tom Wills had got back from Albania from picking up the stores, and he was told of what happened. So he was placed in charge of mining the sheep while Jess Gregson and the other volunteers went searching for the Aborigines to find out where they went to and to get the stuff back. They came across the Aborigines probably about 5 to 10 miles from the main camp, going towards a mountain called Mount Wandoo. And that's where they had their first encounter with the blacks and found out they were outnumbered, so they retreated until more help arrived. Jess Gregson and the native police and everything came across them probably about 10 to 15 miles from the main Horatio's campsite, and that's where they had the retaliation with the blacks, and they estimate anywhere between 100 to 200 blacks were killed in that attack. Main reasons that we have found out is that it could have been over. Jess Gregson, about a week or so beforehand, killed 2 Aborigines for pinching sheep.
It makes my blood boil that Gregson, just for the sake of a few sheep, committed the act which was the cause of the murder of my father and all his party. Men, women and children.
They just phrases from Taroom, they come and they come, the mounted police come and they murdered over 300 odd blacks from Emerald, Springshaw, Bohemia, Ralston, Albania. They shot all the blacks around Albania police station and they went right down as far as Bohemia into the Jeringa area, shooting all around Comet. They shot blacks all in that area.
Horatio's decision to send his son Tom with Jim Baker and Bill Albury back to Albania Downs certainly saved their lives. But when Tom returned to the scene of the massacre on the following Sunday, he was shocked at what he discovered.
He was stunned, of course. On the way up to Cullinaringo, just before they crossed Separation Creek, which is the boundary of Cullinaringo, Jesse Gregson on Rainworth Station had warned them that he was having trouble with Aborigines. Well, he'd had trouble with them pinching his sheep and so forth. And he said they all should be armed, they should carry arms. Although they had all the arms, nobody worried about carrying them because they wanted to present a friendly face to the Aborigines. And Horatio Wills had got on very well with the Aborigines in Victoria. And he used them in his workforce. He wanted to do the same up there. And wanted to just have friendly relations.
What else is interesting is that because of the flooded rivers, he went into Cullinaringo at the wrong end. And it was not the end he intended to go in. And if he'd gone in at the other end, he might still be there.
It is written that a lot of the Aboriginals became camp followers. They followed this huge cavalcade of bullock drays, stock, over 10,000 sheep. It is the biggest settling party that had ever travelled through that area of Queensland.
I think it's very interesting to think about what would have happened if he'd gone into the North End, because he and Tom both had a history of getting on well with Aboriginals.
Yes.
And they got on very well with the Aboriginals in Moyston. And so left to his own devices, up at the northern end of the property, he may very well have got along well with them up there, but he came in at Gregson's end, and the Aboriginal tribe at that end of the property, I think, were pretty fed up, and I think with fairly good reason. So I think that the massacre was, in my view, a classic payback. Okay.
A week later, needing help and advice and feeling a great sense of family obligation, Tom wrote to his cousin Coley Harrison in Victoria.
Letter dated the 24th of October, 1861. Dear Coley, I have had not much time to go into particulars. I can only say that all our party except 6 have been slaughtered by the blacks on the 17th. I'm in a great fix. If we had used common precautions, all would have been well. My poor father and Baker were both most brutally murdered. I want good men up here that thoroughly understand sheep. Please let Mr. Roop. 17th of October, just 9 months from the time we left Melbourne, 19 have been killed. Tell Elliot that poor George was killed close to the tent and had a small switch in his hand that he used to drive the sheep with. I have his pouch now. All the clothes of all sort gone. Flour, sugar and tea not touched, but blankets, shirts and beds were all gone. What a dreadful end after so much trouble we've had. The climate is splendid, but without good men I can do nothing.
Horatio's widow, Elizabeth, wrote with great feeling to her sons at school in Germany, expressing her disbelief at the happenings at Murdering Gap.
My dear boys, you as well as myself have met with so severe a loss that we will not cease to feel it during our whole life. You cannot, my dear children, make yourself believe that you have indeed lost your dear father for the last 3 weeks. I have not been able to persuade myself of the terrible loss we have sustained, but this day we have had a full account of the whole affair. Your father, hearing a loud noise among the blacks, came out to see, having his revolver in his belt. The blacks had struck down one of the women. He had only time to fire one out of 4 barrels when the poor fellow was struck on the dear cheek with a tomahawk, then dreadfully wounded about the neck. The poor women were found in their tent with their sewing in their hands, the man cook in the act of taking the cover off the oven, so that everyone was taken by surprise. May God bless and keep you safe, your affectionate mother, Elizabeth Wills.
And at the time, I think it's roughly 150 kilometres south of Cullinaringo, there'd been the Hornet Bank massacre where 11 people were killed just a few years before that.
That was the Fraser family, wasn't it?
That's right, yes.
And then I believe Jesse Gregson at Rainworth Fort had caused a bit of a problem and called in the native police, is that right?
That's right, yes. He caught Aborigines taking sheep off his property. From the Aborigines' point of view, they thought that these sheep were just running wild and they were just open go to grab a few of them. They did this on lots of properties.
Colleen McLaughlin and Lorna Smith purchased the original homestead block of Old Rainworth from their cousin in 1973. Lorna argues that the building of an impregnable stone fortress by Jesse Gregson the following year in 1862 was really a dual-purpose building to serve as both fort and storehouse. Looking through the rifle slits in the stone walls, it is easy to understand the fear of attack that gripped the early white settlers, a fear also held by the blacks, on whose people ruthless revenge was exacted after the Hornet Bank and Cullinaringo massacres. No Aboriginal attacks were ever made on Rainworth Fort.
I'll go along with his memoirs, because his memoirs are the written word, aren't they?
And that's what Tom said.
And he said he built a large stone storehouse. Yes. And but because of the time in which it was built, because it was started the year after the massacre, you can't be blamed for thinking that he had an ulterior motive in building it like that. And the iron roof, the first iron roof ever in the district.
Really?
Yes. Before that it would have been bark or thatched or something like that could be burnt down.
The 1870 comment was in the district as well. Because when they built their covering your homestead, it had an iron roof.
Yes.
Didn't see, have a shingle roof.
This is 1862. So he was a long way ahead of his time. And why are the doors double thickness of timber? And they're like that, aren't they? They're diagonal, isn't they?
Dual-purpose building, I'd say.
A dual-purpose building, that'll do, yeah.
The massacre ended up being a victory for
great for the tribes, because the whole of Australia saw what was happening.
Yeah, that's true. That's really true. They seen what happened. Well, it didn't go over well with a lot of white people, and that was partly the victory for the Aboriginals in that area. They employed the wielders right up to old Tommy and Coley and Antler. They still employed more Aboriginals than anybody else in the district.
Tom, at the age of 26, stayed on with the few remaining stockmen to build a homestead, yards, fences, and generally set up a working station. It was a huge and daunting task. Tom was made manager in 1862, but it was often tough going with the trustees and family in Victoria.
Tom had been taken out of the sporting world in Melbourne, where he was he had hero status. He was the best cricketer in Australia, I'd say, on all the accounts you read. He was captain of the Victorian cricket team. He'd founded Australian rules. He was a celebrity. And he'd been taken out of that life onto work and manage a station that he'd had very little to do with. Like, while his father was on the property in Victoria, Tom was away at school in England, at rugby school. And to ask him to, expect him to run a huge property, a 200 square mile property, with over 10,000 stock on it, was a big ask.
He's telling his mother, I'm obliged to put up a good shed, one that'll last 4 or 5 years, at the cost of £200 and all. Also, we've got lambing coming up. I'm required a great amount of labour. Mr. Debs, a squatter from Peak Downs, was here the other night. He has 10,000 sheep, the largest run in Queensland. A good judge besides, he values his run at £2 a head all over. And he said this run, if put on the market, would realise £2, 10 shillings all round. And as we shall shear 11,700 head this year, if nothing occurs, we should be able to get £30,000. So if the trustees will let us have the money, we will repay, even if they have to borrow it, and it can be returned in a few years. And then after the trustees sold up the place, Conalinga sold in 1883 for £106,000.
And Tom certainly did his best, and he vowed over his father's grave that he would do what his father would expect him to do. And that was look after the property and to see it developed successfully.
When his brother Cedric returned to the station from school in 1862, Tom was able to head back to Victoria briefly to see his fiancée Sarah Anderson of Skipton and his family at Geelong. And in February 1863, he was selected as captain in the 5th intercolonial match against old rivals New South Wales. But back at Cullen-Laringo, Tom's relations with Uncle Roop and the trustees deteriorated. Tom's desperate plea for further funds to run the station was frowned on.
And Uncle Willie never gave a good report on Tom, because Tom and him fell out about everything, apparently. And their relatives in Victoria just did not know the property. And all I could see was Tom wanting money to spend on yards and to spend on fencing and to spend on buildings. They seemed to see it as a bottomless pit.
By late December 1863, the shearing was completed. And leaving younger brother Cedric in charge, Tom headed south to play cricket against the English touring 11, captained by the legendary batsman George Parr. There was loud applause when Tommy Wills finally got off the steamer from Queensland and arrived at the Melbourne cricket ground. But the news was not all good. Sarah Anderson, disturbed at Tom's unsettled life and his reported drinking problems, cancelled the engagement. Tom avoided the family and sailed for a cricket tour of New Zealand. His mother, Elizabeth, wrote to Cedric, "Tom is not near the man for work as your poor father was." And the trustees, under the terms of Horatio's will, determined Tom should resign from management of the station.
Geelong, February 20th, 1864.
Mr. Cedric S. Wills, Culling Laringo. Dear Sir, by my letter, you will see the trustees are taking every precaution to prevent any trifling with station funds, and it is for this cause mostly they have an agent at the station. You are right as to the trustees' proposal, following the terms of the will, to remove your brother from the station. Your brother has been to New Zealand with the cricketers, and I believe he is daily expected back. W.F. Ducker.
Writes to his brother. Mr. Morris, Mr. Ducker, my mother and self had a grand meeting the other night. It is ultimately decided that I should not return to the station. It is more satisfactory for me to resign the management until the 10 years are over. Asking Cedric to look after his old horse Jack, which was the horse that Horatio took up to Converinga. And Baker, I suppose, will still be left on. He is one of the surviving members of the massacre. And don't let Mr. Johnson ill use the sheep. So Tom was then turning around giving Cedric instructions on how everything was to go, but the trustees had no faith in him.
In 1881, Cullen Laringo was put up for sale and was purchased by Cedric, Horace and Egbert with sisters Lizzie and Minna.
When the time came that the will said that the property had to be sold, Cedric and Horace bought it, but they also had some money from Egbert and from Aunt Minna. And I think Egbert put in something like 3/16 and Aunt Minna put in 1/16 and the other two put in the rest. And they bought Tom out early in the piece.
Cedric continued to manage for a further 11 years until, in July 1892, the family finally put Horatio's Cullen Laringo station on the open market. Cedric and his wife, Berry, settled on neighbouring Minerva Creek Station with their growing family of 12. Today, their descendants still own the property. Resigned to his destiny, Tom celebrated his sister Emily's marriage to his favourite cousin and football colleague, Coley Harrison, in Geelong, November 1864. He now returned to his beloved sport by taking Richmond Cricket Club to victory as captain and champion bowler in the 1864-65 season and becoming a leading player for Geelong's new football team. When he flew so high,
they said it was fantastic. Let me state that my first remembrance of Tommy Wills was a match at Kennington Oval, where we were on opposite sides. He was pointed out to me as that young fellow from rugby who plays with a 4-pound bat and hits terrific. In those days, hundreds, if I might say thousands, congregated of an evening to watch the practice. The observed of all observers, with his Zingari stripe and somewhat flash get-up, fresh from rugby and college, with the polish of the old country upon him. He was then a model of muscular Christianity. He returned 4th of January 1864, in time to play the second English team, and I well recollect the cheer that greeted his appearance on the field on that occasion.
Tommy Wills, to me, is a bit like Zola Butter, someone who is fundamentally a sportsman in whom huge historical forces come to rest, unbeknownst to them. And so he's gone from, you know, growing up with Aboriginal kids, then he comes to school in Melbourne for a while, gets a black eye the first time he ever plays cricket, then he goes to England at 15 and he dominates a school at sport, which puts a spiritual value on sport. And he comes back here and he's an English dandy when he steps off the boat. And he completely takes Victorian cricket by storm. And I think if you love sport, you would have seen a character like him, flamboyant, buck, can carry it off, can play. And he then revolutionises Victorian cricket, and at a time when Victoria is desperate for symbolic presentation of its departure from New South Wales.
The cricketing public in Melbourne were just mad for, to improve their standard. They were playing hotly contested matches against New South Wales. These intercolonial matches were terribly important. The newspapers of the time, if you read them, almost give a ball-to-ball account of the play. Like the news when the Victorian team went to Sydney, it took weeks for the reports to come back. And everyone was waiting to hear how that got on. And the New South Wales team were defeating Victoria, and as soon as Tom arrived back, they were straight onto him to practice for the Victorian team, which they did, of course, and he was selected straight away.
In 1864, Tom was playing for Richmond Club, but such was his popularity, he accepted matches against England at Bendigo, Ballarat, Ararat and Maryborough. If his batting was not always up to scratch, his bowling was top class, including 6 wickets for 35 in Bendigo. He produced sensational bowling against the English, and in one match, Wills took a hat trick.
Wills created a sensation by bowling out Kelly and then flooring the timbers of Julius Caesar and Carpenter for a pair of spectacles with successive balls. In bowling, he took 35 wickets for 460 runs during the season.
But Tom certainly excelled as a bowler. He's a great fieldsman and a tremendous tactician, apparently, as a captain. He was just a very good cricketer.
Well, he captained Victoria for many years and was certainly in terms of the Australian-born cricketers, he was looked on as the W.G. Grace of Australia.
Tom Wills was at the zenith of his cricketing career. Playing for Richmond, he maintained the club as premiers and was the champion bowler in 64-65 before transferring to his old club, Melbourne. In the ninth intercolonial match in December 1865, Tommy Wills, as captain of Victoria, was again in fine form, scoring 58 runs in one innings and taking 6 wickets.
His highest score was 58, which was the first half century scored in these matches. But as a bowler, he excelled. He took 72 wickets for 756 runs at an average of 10.5 per wicket, far superior to any other bowler of the time.
He was a good all-rounder, but mainly as a bowler. It was at a time when the laws of cricket were changing in a fundamental way from round-arm bowling to, in the 1860s, overarm bowling as we know it today, then called windmill bowling. Now, in bowling round arm, the arm came higher than the shoulder, it was either a no ball or, as I understand it, perhaps even referred to as a throw. Wills apparently was a mixture of maybe they were real throws, sometimes maybe it was just over the shoulder, I'm not quite sure. Giving him the benefit of the doubt, you would say that it was round arm over the shoulder. Other people have thought that he was a chucker. But the first regarded as the first test match was played in March 1877. So we're talking about the period 10, 20 years before that, in Wills, when he was at the prime of his career. But if there had been an all-Australian team then, Wills most certainly would have been a star player and could well have been the captain.
A lot of people expressed reservations about the way he played games. I mean, he played it hard. His behaviour was often interpreted as petulant and selfish, though no doubt he had a good reason for what he did. It's just that the others couldn't pick it up. But I remember once there was trouble because he wasn't made captain, and by that stage he'd become a professional and he wasn't being treated in the same way as the other sort of gentleman amateurs. So he straddles that divide in the history of sport as well. But I mean, there's always the recurring story that he chucked. Well, should have instead of bowling.
In 1861-62, H.H. Stevenson brought out the first English 11 to play cricket in Australia. It was just prior to the arrival of that team that Horatio and enticed Thomas Wentworth Wills, his son, to leave Victoria and go to the back blocks out of Rockhampton, it would have been a totally new experience for Tom. And to think that he was up there in Queensland at the time when H.H. Stevenson's was playing, 11 was playing here in Victoria, and Tommy wasn't part of the Victorian team.
I think after the massacre, he carried the maybe the guilt of that, because his father really went up there to establish a property for Tom and his other brothers. And one of his nieces wrote afterwards that Tom was such an outgoing, well-liked person that she said that everyone wanted to have a drink with him. He was tremendously popular, and of course Tom was happy to have a drink with them, and yeah, this just didn't help. And the social side is cricket or any sport really. You know, even today there's plenty of drinking goes on with it.
He's a magnificent young man, a really proud, wonderfully endowed young man. But history has placed an intolerable burden on him. I mean, it's not just that when he was up there and his father's party got wiped out, then there's the reprisal raids, and he's actually up there in the middle of a land war. And there's all sorts of things that flow on that he would have known about that from his early upbringing. And so that's just enormous. And then by the time he gets back down here, despite what people say, he was on the outer. He was already regarded as trouble. And I mean, he'd already had huge run-ins with the Melbourne club by then. And he's sort of on the outer and he's hardly understood. And by that time, he's a big drinker. He's a big drinker by the time he gets back from England. I mean, he's played cricket with the Isengari. They're the sort of Mick Jaggers of 19th century cricket, you know, in beautiful clothes who play cricket by day and drink by night. They're aristocrats.
Well, he played cricket in a lot of places. I mean, he went to New Zealand, as you know. W.G. Grace said that he was in every team that they played on his tour of Australia. So he was what I would describe, he would go anywhere for a cricket match, anywhere that would pay him.
Yes,
Tom was a cricket bum.
Yeah, his personality was fascinating. I mean, he was charismatic, and at times he was narcissistic. And there's no doubt that he had a flair for conflict. At times he was a little prickly. But I think that you have to put that also in the guise of someone who was quite creative as well. And so some of that was his personality as such. But he was continually, I think, trying out new things, trying out different roles. Almost each year he indeed undertook different aspects or tried to fulfil different aspects of sport.
Victorian football was virtually instigated by Tommy Wills to keep his fellow cricketers fit and on the ball.
What Wills did that was so unusual was that at a time when this society was importing every possible British cultural characteristic that it could, and the subject of a code of football arose, his radical act was to say, when rugby was proposed as a game, no, we should have a game of our own. And the question is, why did he do that? And I think the reason he did that was because he was a sportsman of genius, which meant that he had an intuitive and original understanding of sport and of games, and he'd seen other ways of playing football.
And he wanted to keep the camaraderie of the players, he wanted to keep them together. And he advocated a winter sport. Now, interestingly, the sports that he chose were either rifle shooting, which was had a big following at the time, and football.
This is the letter which Thomas Wentworth Wills wrote to the Bell's Life of Victoria on the 16th of July, 1858. Sir, now that cricket has been put aside for some few months to come, and cricketers have assumed somewhat of a chrysalis nature, why can they not, I say, form a football club and form a committee of three or more to draw up a code of laws? If a club of this sort were got up, it would be a vast benefit to any cricket ground to be trampled upon, and would make the turf quite firm and durable. If it is not possible to form a football club, why should not these young men who have adopted this newborn country for their motherland, why, I say, do not they form themselves into perhaps a rifle club?
Anyway, football was the one they chose, and this was really where Australian rules originated.
A firm heart, a steady hand, and a quick eye are all that are required, and with practice, all these may be attained, trusting that someone will take up this matter and form either of the above clubs, or at any rate, some athletic games. I remain yours truly, Thomas Wentworth Wills.
When he was in England, he'd been to Ireland, and he'd seen Gaelic football there, apparently, but he wanted more a kicking, running game. He didn't want a lot of heavy tackling, as in rugby, because the grounds in Australia weren't like the soft turf grounds in England.
Gaelic football is not codified to the 1880s. Australian football is codified in 1858. So that means ours is the older game. Hurley, the Irish hockey game, is thousands of years old. But Irish football is a much more recent game. There is a spirit to games, and the Gaelic games have a certain spirit. And there were certainly Irish people around at the time the game was exploding into life, which is what it basically did. And I have no doubt that a lot of the spirit of that period of Australian football's early evolution, 1858 to 1880, that is the period of Ned Kelly.
It also seemed the Aborigines, this theory's been brought forward, playing a game called Mangrook, and where they threw a type of ball around among them and caught it and played with this. Some people say he got the idea from there.
And the local mythology has it that the Australian Wills football was originally the game that the Wills boys played with the local boys in the Ararat area. The whole family seemed to be on good terms with the Western District people right through.
So this question of whether Australian football is an Aboriginal game, my answer to that is, I can say as a fact that around Australia, I have encountered the belief amongst Aboriginal people that it is. The other thing that to me is really important, what makes Australian football so incredibly important, is that it is one of the very few places where black legends and white legends come out of the same piece of ground.
Each public school in Britain had its own particular game of football which suited the particular circumstances of that school, and there was no one code such as we know it today, soccer or rugby, in any of those schools. But there was a difference between the game played at rugby with most of the other public schools was they allowed the players to pick up the ball and run with it.
The time was ready for it. I mean, he also suggested athletics club and a rifle club, when neither of those really got off the ground. So he was writing a letter into fertile ground, as it were.
To take out the best of all what they knew of the English public school games,
yes,
and synthesise them to a game which would suit Melbourne conditions or Australian conditions best of all.
And if you investigate the early history of rugby, it's based on European notions of infantry and cavalry. And in Tom Brown's school days, the forward pack is called the heavy brigade and the backs are called the light brigade. And most football games have some sort of military model at work in them. Tommy Wills was more interested in cricket, I think, than he was in football, at least initially. And his objection to the offside rule was that it showed it was for captains who couldn't set a field, didn't have any imagination, because you'll have to line up behind the ball. And it was just a typically Tom Wills idea, like people should bowl over arm.
I mean, the rules are set out in May 1859, okay. And after that they play lots of football every Saturday. A lot of young men had come to Melbourne for the gold, and once they'd drifted back into the city or discovered there wasn't, you know, a living to be made, like all young men, they wanted to play sport. Cricket was already organised, football wasn't, so it was a logical thing to do. I know that Tom's letter suggests that he it would help keep cricketers fit.
Well, after that letter that was written to Bell's life, there was a match between Scotch College and Melbourne Grammar, which went over about almost a month before it was settled, with numerous players on both sides.
It was played on Richmond Paddock in Yarra Park, with Wills as one of the umpires. Modified rugby rules were used in a round ball as in soccer. Each team had 40 players, and the first team to kick two goals was to be the winner. Goalposts were half a mile apart and scoring was difficult. Scotch College scored the first goal. But finally, after almost a month, the game ended in a draw.
Which is a game that generally is looked on as one that helped lead to the formation of Australian rules football.
And I believe it lasted nearly a month, is that right?
It was on and off for a while. It took a couple of weeks. And they were rained out initially and it was wet, and then they had a game and there was no score, and they came back the next week and then somebody finally scored. It did go on and on. And they experimented with a few different rules.
In May 1859, following the next cricket season, the Melbourne Football Club was formed with Tommy Wills as captain. At a meeting at Bryant's Parade Hotel, 10 formal rules of play for the new game were drawn up by Tommy Wills and a club committee. The rules included such features as the mark, the boundary throw-in, and a ban on throwing the ball, rules which still exist. Rugby offside rules were dispensed with to open up the game. Ironically, this code of footy is older than most other football codes. Such was the popularity of the new code that within the first two decades, scores of clubs were formed throughout the state, with 100 clubs in Melbourne alone.
Teams were known as the Melbourne Cricketers Football Club, the Richmond Cricketers Football Club, etc. And the players then were not tied to a particular team like they are today and need to be transferred in a formal way. They could move around and play for Geelong this week and Richmond next week.
Was Tommy a great footballer?
Oh yes. He would have played well over 200 games of football. He was a star footballer in his day. But we haven't got much record of it. And of course the game has changed so much that it's hard to compare it with today's football stars like James Hird of Essendon.
He was voted the best player in the colony.
Tommy Wills' main contribution to the code and conduct of Australian football was made from 1858 to 1860. But on his return from Queensland, he continued playing with enthusiasm and was a leading player for Geelong.
I think that Tom Wills is probably the most important sportsman in Australian history, which is perhaps an extraordinary statement to make, but I think when you look at his influence, not only in his lifetime, but the legacy, one may find other sportsmen and women who have perhaps achieved more in terms of an individual sport, but I think the ripples of his effect are profound.
In May 1866, 12 new code rules for Melbourne football were adopted. Although Tommy Wills had considerable input into these rules, they were officially drafted by Tom's cousin and brother-in-law, Collie Harrison.
Carlton Harrison carried on with it, and he had a lot more to do with it than Tom did, and I think this is why they gave him the title of Father of Australian Football. The title maybe could have been Tom's if he hadn't gone off to Cullinaringo.
Well, when the rules were first set out, Tom was there, but Colden wasn't. Colden didn't have any experience of football at that stage. Tom had experience of football at rugby school in England, but Harrison, when he took up football, turned out to be probably the best footballer in Victoria in the 1860s, was captain of the Melbourne football side, and later, once he stopped actually playing football, was a very efficient administrator of the game.
In 1867, Harrison led the Melbourne club in a football match against the Victorian police force on the hallowed turf of Melbourne Cricket Club.
Harrison was younger than Tommy Wills. And here is Tommy Wills coming back from rugby as a great personality and a great sportsman and so forth. And the younger Colden Harrison would have been in awe of him, I would say. So he fathered it through a period, if you like, but he didn't sire the game or help sire the game in that sense of fatherhood.
In this year, the oval ball came into universal usage, replacing the round ball.
14th of May 1860, between Richmond and Melbourne, and Tommy's captaining Richmond. And this is the Argus. Another drawback to an otherwise almost a perfect afternoon's enjoyment was the objectionable shape of the ball, which was oval, and is said to have gained the prize at the Great Exhibition, being of the new kind now in use at rugby school. This class of ball may fly further than a round one, but assuredly in 9 times out of 10, does not fulfil the expectations of the propeller, more particularly if there be any wind. Considerable dissatisfaction was expressed when the game began, at the Richmond captains maintaining his right to the choice of the ball, and a great deal more after the play was over. That's Tommy. There can be no objection to a man playing football in thigh boots or in pumps, if he has a weakness in that way, for no one else suffers. But the ball is, as it were, common property, and any abnormal condition in it affects all of it.
This early game of Melbourne rules has today become Australian rules football, a game described as a religion with individual players afforded hero status. Hundreds of thousands attend AFL matches today. A record crowd of over 121,000 fans barracked for Carlton and Collingwood back in their 1970 Grand Final. Such an outcome in 1858 would have been unbelievable. Almost caught the sun. Maybe you caught Tom Wills returning from Old Blighty. Maybe you bought Tom Wills a drink or two one night. Maybe you thought Tom. In November 1866, a group of enthusiastic Western District cricketers approached Tom Wills to coach a talented Aboriginal country team. Some thought the choice of Wills surprising, considering the family tragedy at Cullen-Laringo. On the other hand, Wills had grown up among Western Victorian blacks at Lexington. He knew their language, their customs, and, as a boy, had regarded many of them as his friends.
In fact, it was the first Australian cricket team to tour England of any, you know, whether they were white players or black players. And there had been a bit of cricket played among the Aborigines. They got involved and they were athletic and they took to the game like magic, and they played very well. And they wanted a coach for this team down at Edenhope, and Tom applied for this job, and he, despite the Cullen-Laringo massacre, Tom apparently had come to terms with that. He'd worked among the Aborigines, and when he was in rugby even, his father wrote a letter saying how the Aborigines on the property at Lexington missed him, and how they wanted to see his photo, and how they asked, where was Tom? What was Tom doing?
Tommy travelled to Lake Wallace near Hamilton to coach and captain this talented team. A match was arranged at the Melbourne Cricket Ground for Boxing Day.
It was within 5 years that he's back in Victoria and coaching an Aboriginal, the first Aboriginal cricket team.
Really, this was reconciliation, if you like. It was certainly a tremendous gesture.
The Melbourne Cricket Club offered to send down one of their number, namely Thomas Wentworth Wills, to help sharpen the skills of the Aboriginal cricketers in the Edenhope Harrow area, which he did, and then he captained the team, brought them back to Melbourne. They played on the Melbourne Cricket Ground, did reasonably well, and from then on they were encouraged to extend the tour into New South Wales, and they played a series of matches there.
The smartly attired Aboriginal team captivated a crowd of 10,000 on the ground and further thousands on the hill. The Aborigines in the first innings, overawed by the huge crowd, made only 39 runs, but in the second innings performed well, with Johnny Muller scoring 33 and Tom Wills 25 not out. The best Aboriginal bowler was Johnny Cousins, who took 6 for 24. Although the MCC won the match, the Indigenous team won the hearts of the crowd. Tom Wills' popularity among the team was obvious when a reporter from the Bendigo Advertiser suggested to team character Jellicoe that Tom should teach him to read and write. Jellicoe replied, "What use he Wills? He too much along of us. He speak nothing now but blackfellow talk." On the third day, a sports meeting was held. The crowd were entertained with spear and boomerang throwing. The 100 yards race, with competitors running backwards, was won by Tarpot. Throwing the cricket ball, won by Bullocky, with a throw of 91¾ yards. And high jumping ended in a tie between Tom's cousin, Coley Harrison, and Tarpot at 5 feet 3 inches. A national tour and later a trip to England was proposed, with Tom Wills as captain and Western District cricketer Bill Hayman as manager. The local tour began well, however interference from a confidence man known as Captain Gurnett almost destroyed the team's opportunities, with both manager Hayman and coach Tommy Wills accused by the bankrupt Captain Gurnett of breach of contract.
They were approached by a con man who was going to do everything for them and did very little.
High-profile English professional cricketer and captain of New South Wales, Charles Lawrence, took up the challenge and in 1868 set sail for England with the Aboriginal team that Wills had coached and captained. Hayman went along as manager. Tom had played with Lawrence many years before in Ireland and knew him well. But as Longstop wrote later, Tommy Wills would have been disappointed, if not offended, by being excluded from further involvement with the Aborigines.
Really, it wasn't a matter of Lawrence displacing Wills or Wills not being selected or whatever. It was more the effect of picking the best man for the job. And if I had the same task of picking him, you'd have to go for Lawrence every time.
Well, to me, Tommy Wills is Hamlet. He's Australian Hamlet. I think Muller's Othello, but Tommy Wills is the young man with the decision placed upon him, or the historical circumstance placed upon him, which is actually too great for him to resolve. And the question you often get asked is, why do you go down and coach the cricket team? And that's the Aboriginal cricket team. That's clearly got to be one of the key questions. And if he had taken them to Lords, they would have won that game, probably. He would have been the first Australian captain at Lords to win at Lords.
One incident reported in the Hamilton Spectator in late 1867, during the team's overseas tour preparation, indicated that further cricket overseas would be doomed for Indigenous people. In order to escape the eagle eye of the powerful State Aboriginal Protection Board, it was found necessary to spirit team members from a picnic at Queenscliff out of the colony and onto Sydney by steamer. The Act in 1869 placed penalties of up to £20 or 3 months imprisonment on anyone attempting to remove any Aboriginal from Victoria without the consent of the minister. This meant that the government of the day could curb all opportunities for further Aboriginal tours, especially those organised as private ventures. Aboriginal tour was a great success. A decade before the first white Australian team played at Lords, and 14 years before the Ashes were created.
Oh, they're real entertainers. They were colourfully, they had entertaining names like Bullocky, Dicker Dick, all sorts of names, and they were colourfully dressed. I think it's described in the newspapers, with colourful red shirts, white flannel trousers, blue diagonal sashes, and distinguishing individual coloured caps. They were there for the best part of a year, including travelling both ways. And they played, I think it was 47 matches, of which they won 14, drew 17, and they were there a decade or more before the first white Australian team toured England.
Cricket returns to the castle.
It's from the Yorkshire Post. It's got a photo of the Aboriginal team that played there in 1868 and of the famous castle, Scarborough Hill Castle. And they've started playing cricket there again, apparently they had a break of 70 odd years. And this is to commemorate the resurgence of cricket again at the castle.
In October 1951, a memorial was unveiled at Edenhope near Lake Wallace to commemorate the feats of this famous Aboriginal team. The monument is located where the team practiced. It has two bronze plaques. One lists the names of the players and the captain and manager, Lawrence and Heyman.
When I went to Edenhope and Harrow, and I learnt a lot more about that first Aboriginal team, and not only learned a lot more about them, but I learned what they went through to, just for starters, to even get on the tour was an amazing thing. But then to go through what must be, in those days, a horrendous trip to England. And then you get to the other end and the conditions in England will be totally different to what they would have experienced in Australia playing cricket. A lot colder, different sort of pitches, everything, totally different. So to go through all of that and then complete a pretty arduous tour. You know, the program was pretty tough. They completed it honourably, you know, they played well. But they also entertained the people, not just with their cricket, but with their other skills as well. And when I found out about this, I thought to myself, well, you know, if it hadn't have been for these guys, if these guys hadn't have gone there, or if they hadn't have gone there and been so successful, it wouldn't have been so easy for the next team to come, and so on. And that filters all the way down to the teams that I played in and the current Australian team.
The first Aboriginal cricket team that went to England, we were we never knew about them because they went from Victoria, and Victoria was, you might as well say, another country. It was only later in life that we'd found all this out, and I thought it was excellent that they were the first ones going over there, and I think it's excellent that Ian Chappell's recognised that and he's trying to get things started for them.
I think that what they did, what they achieved, puts them on a par with all the other 400-odd people who have played cricket for Australia.
I think they should be recognised as along with anyone else because they were the first and they were the trailblazers, if you'd like to call it that, because they went over there, they played a heap of games, and they won a heap, drew a heap, and they lost a few, but it must have been a good thing for them.
I think there's a deserving case for Johnny Muller to be included in the Hall of Fame, because if you're looking at the Hall of Fame, there's a number of criteria that you would have to satisfy to get into the Hall of Fame. But to me, one of the very important things is to be, if not the outstanding player in your time, one of the outstanding players in your time. And I don't think that you could possibly argue with what Johnny Muller did on that tour, that he wasn't the outstanding player in that team. And as such, I think he deserves to be included in the Hall of Fame, as well as being recognised as an Australian cricketer. If we accord recognition to the first Australian team, then it starts to set a bit of a tradition amongst Aboriginal sportsmen. And I mean, a lot of people say to you, why do a lot of Aboriginal sportsmen, you know, they're very good footballers in all the different codes of football, but they don't seem to gravitate towards cricket much. And you sort of say, well, I don't think they were given much encouragement, and also there's no great tradition there in cricket for them to follow.
When we went to Brisbane and played down there, it was the first time I'd heard of Eddie Goob, and just following what he went through as far as prejudice and everything went, and he never ever got a run because of his colour, I suppose, and I was down there with another Aboriginal cricketer named Ian King. He played for Queensland, actually. And that went on for about 5 years, and I just got sick of it and said, told me, missus, I said, let's pack our bags and go home. We're not going to get anywhere here. As far as prejudice went, We struck it in Brisbane, around the clubs, but in when we went back to North Queensland and played up there, there was never any prejudice against any black cricketer, and there was heaps of them up there, and good cricketers too.
You know, I guess the preference for living for your average Aboriginal is in the bush, not in the cities. You know, they much prefer to live, you know, out because of their association with the land and their feeling for the land. So I guess there's always that difficulty of, you know, if you want to be recognised as a good cricketer, sooner or later you've basically got to come to the city. And I guess that's one hurdle that the game of cricket has got to overcome.
Yeah, well, there's quite a few young Aboriginal cricketers playing around at the moment. A lot of, most of them are playing football. I think, myself, I think the football is a cheaper option as far as sport goes. With cricket, you need all the gear and you need a lot of travel. And with football, you just put on a pair of boots and a pair of shorts and front up and you get a game. And it costs you nothing. Finance is the biggest problem. Finance and distance is the biggest problem.
I think what is important is that they went and they performed well. And in my opinion, they made it easier for the teams that have followed. And to me, that's the thing that matters.
The second plaque celebrates the first Australian cricket team to tour England. But the name of Tommy Wills, who did so much to develop the skills of this extraordinary team, is not included.
The people who write that cricket was a gentleman's game and what's happened to the gentleman's game, they don't know anything about the history of the game of cricket, because it started in pubs and with betting. It's always been a game of conflict and controversy, and it sounds to me like Tom Wills was one of those captains who, he was in charge of his team and he was going to stand up for them.
There is a monument at Moyston near the former Wills property, Lexington, at the foot of Mount Ararat, which does celebrate Tommy Wills. And so do the bronze gates at the Melbourne Cricket Ground.
That was one of the club's 150th birthday presents, I suppose, to itself, was the formation of the bronze gates at the corner entrance. There was a commission done. Robert Inkpen, I think, was the artist. And the gates are opened by the Governor-General just around the 150th birthday of the club, which should be September 1988.
Well, look, I think he was certainly, by his contemporaries, he was revered. The wider family tried to distance themselves from the the disgrace or whatever involved. And in doing so, poor old Tom became the back number. When the Great Southern Stand was being planned, internally within the Melbourne Cricket Club, we lobbied very, very strongly that T.W. Wills should be recognised. And of course, there is the Wills Room at the Melbourne Cricket Ground now, recognition of his services. And you've seen the bronze gates.
Yes.
You've had a good look at them. There's only one person who features on that twice, and that's Thomas Wentworth Wills.
In cricket, Tom Wills continued to go from strength to strength, and in 1870-71 became editor of the Australian Cricketer's Guide.
My dear Tom, I heartily wish you success in your undertaking, for it has too long been a disgrace to cricketers that they have not come forward in support of a permanent chronicle for their deeds of prowess on the green sward. The Cricketer's Guide ought to be as much a Victorian institution as the Turf Register. You first want my notions about cricket? Well then, I say that the bowling usually indulged in now is not bowling at all. To bump a ball, and so either frighten or endanger a batsman's limbs and trunk, is simply not cricket. A lazy lot of young vagabonds see Conway bowl high, or Wills chuck an odd one in. Straight away they feel inspired to sling and put them down, regardless of pace, pitch, or the normal play of the batsman. Again, wishing you success in your undertaking, I remain, my dear Tom, yours truly, J.B. Thompson.
Thank you. As the 1870s drew to a close, Tommy Wills was living at Heidelberg in a de facto relationship with Sarah Teresa Barber. He was drinking heavily and had largely drifted out of public view. His mother, some members of the family and some of his former friends had disowned him.
And of course that was a total scandal because my Elizabeth, she didn't approve of anything like that at all. Interesting, in the Australian Dictionary of Biography it said that Tom married her, but he never did. He couldn't.
He lived in a de facto relationship, which she didn't approve of. And his wife, or his de facto, was also a heavy drinker apparently. And his mother was very religious, and this just didn't fit in with her way of life at all. His drinking was to the stage where he was getting the DTs, the delirium tremens.
She was a maternal figure, a somewhat imposing dowager who really cast a shadow, I think, over her children's lives after the death of Horatio. And she probably had their welfare at heart and was very concerned about material matters, and again, had good reason to be, because she had seen much of her material wealth dissipate over a period of time.
His payments from the sale of Cullen Baringo, controlled by Mr. Ducker, were grossly inadequate, and he wrote to Cedric asking for a loan of £10.
In this letter to Horace, the last one he wrote, while known to Britain, shows that on the 15th of March 1880, he writes, "Dear Horace, many thanks for your order on Ducker, the £10 which I duly received from him. I received from Ducker out of the allowance £3 weekly, in which he retains £1 to pay off old debts that are still owing in Geelong. De facto wife Sally joined with him in sending all love. I write Sadie by this mail also, so if he sends £10, I shall be clear to move and be very glad of it."
Despite the greatness of his cricket and football achievements, there was always the reoccurring nightmare of that tragic massacre at Cullen Baringo. With his outgoing personality and early sporting success, Tom may have regarded himself as a failure.
So Cullen Baringo and the killing of his father and Tom's reaction to it had a profound effect upon him. That I think we know from the letters. People who survive trauma often undergo significant changes in the way they think, the way they feel, and even their bodily experiences. And again, we have evidence from private letters and newspaper reports that the impact of that trauma affected him physically, and affected him psychologically.
On April the 28th, 1880, his heavy drinking resulted in his being placed under restraint.
Now, he suffered from delirium tremens. Firstly, that diagnosis was made when he was admitted to the Melbourne Hospital on May the 1st, the day before he committed suicide. Now, delirium tremens was an extremely well-known entity at that particular time. So it would be a diagnosis that was known to the medical staff, and so they would be confident in their diagnosis. When Tom Wills was admitted to hospital, and certainly soon afterwards, he began to see apparitions. He felt persecuted, and this was reflected in his behaviour.
"I just give you particulars of poor old Tom. He and Sarah had been drinking to such an extent that he got into the horrors very bad, and as Sarah could not manage him on the 1st of May, Saturday, she took him into the hospital in the morning. Well, on Saturday night, Sarah was awakened at about 11 by some woman who had told her that Tom was on the veranda, so she got up to let him in. Then all night he spoke in a very queer way. He told Sarah that they had to die. And about 12, the old man who was watching him said, 'Mr. Wills, I'm going to dinner.' And Tom said, 'All right,' and went into the kitchen where Sarah and the girl were. Before this, they had hidden every sharp instrument around the house. When in the kitchen, the girl saw him pick up and tried two small knives, but they bent too easily. And when Sarah looked up and saw him with his arm raised and a pair of scissors in his hands, he then struck himself in the chest He ran and caught his arm, but then he'd struck himself twice more, falling at least at last and onto his elbows. They laid him on his bed, but he was dead within 2 minutes. He must have touched the heart, but he never spoke after he fell. Tom had told Sarah to write and tell Mama and to go to Ducker to arrange her affairs. I'll send you a paper with remarks about Tom. 3 wounds through the vest and shirt, bled very little.
The inquest noted that the deceased committed suicide while of unsound mind from excessive drinking. Thomas Wentworth Wills was buried on the hilltop in Warrigal Cemetery, Heidelberg. His burial arranged by his brother Egbert, sister Emily, and cousin Collie Harrison. His grave was only marked by a tombstone many years later when the Melbourne Cricket Club decided recognition should be paid to Tommy Wills in appreciation of his contribution to sport. The founder of Australian football and champion cricketer of his time is etched in gold letters on the tombstone. The Australasian reported, "If Tommy Wills had an enemy in this world, that enemy, unhappily, was himself alone."
I think he was someone who was quite impulsive at times, who followed his whims, and whatever the fallout was, it was.
Tommy Wills is the first of the gentlemen sportsmen to be on first name terms with the crowd, otherwise called the mob. And they used to call him Tommy. And that was another aspect in the big power play over him, because not only was the best sportsman, he had the affection of the crowd.
They really loved him.
Yeah, they loved Tommy. Well, why wouldn't they? He was the best.
Ours is a small club, we're not well known. News of us is growing among the young and old. More loyal bunch of players you'd never find. And who'd be our coach? Tom Wills Wood. Tom Wills Wood. We don't often win, when we do it's pandemonium. More often it's a taste of defeat we have to eat. There's always next week, we'll beat 'em yet. Tom Wills Wood. Tom Wills Wood. We're a determined bunch of tries and we stick to a plan. Worn down many a team of fancied money champions. We play with guile and wit and true team spirit. It's Tom Wills Wood. Tom Wills Wood. If we're here now, we could. Tom Wills Wood. So if you're thinking to drop me from a team, I won't go quietly, I'll go mean. Bugger me age and me cranky ways, I'll send my bones to the contest again. It's Tom Wills Wood. Tom Wills Wood. He'd be there if he could. Tom Wills Wood. When shadows draw along on my final day of play, don't drag me to a cold room, don't send me off that way. Let me run on burning bright with dance and song, and stun the opposition. It's Tom Wills Wood. Tom Wills Wood. If we were here now, we could. Tom Wills Wood. If I'm shunned and ignored by the mighty who preside, I'll not curry for their favor, I'll not bootlick at their side. I'll be gone with those who knew me well. My dark friends have died in their own sad hell. It's Tom Wills Wood. Tom Wills Wood. If we were here now, we could. Tom Wills Wood. He'd be there if he could. Tom Wills Wood. Tom Wills Wood.
Didn't you see Tom Wills playing by the river? Didn't you hear Tom Wills roaring in the town? How would you beat Tom Wills punishing his liver? Could you believe Tom Wills just threw the wicket down? When he flew so high, they said it was fantastic. Up and over everyone. My, oh my, nothing short of drastic. He almost caught the sun. Maybe you caught Tom Wills returning from old Blighty. Maybe you bought Tom Wills a drink or two one night. Maybe you thought Tom Wills was nothing if not mighty. Maybe you caught his dream as it disappeared from sight. When he flew so high, they said it was fantastic. Up and over everyone. My, oh my, nothing short of drastic. He almost caught the sun. Maybe you saw Tom Wills punishing the leather. Did you adore Tom Wills striding to the crease? Could you ignore Tom Wills in the game for any weather? Did you deplore Tom Wills when the cheers began to cease? And in Heidelberg, conveniently forgotten, the world had no more use for one. Early ripe, he almost caught the sun. Yay! There's a tribe down in the western district that talked of one came onto their land, learnt their tongue, learnt their way of living, played their game they could never understand. How we flew so high.